And now I want to talk to Mark, one of the young men at the foundation. Mark, tell me how you came to get the foundation.
Sue, I was a musician in the world for 17 years, and with each year that went by, I was more miserable. And I heard about Jesus Christ all my life, but I didn't know how to serve him. And I was working as a music copyist for publishing companies in Hollywood. And one day, four gospel songs came across the desk, and suddenly these gospel songs seemed to just stand out above all the rest of the songs I had been copying. And shortly after that, I realized that truth was in these gospel songs, and there was no truth in any other kind of songs in the world. And shortly after that, I got on my knees in my room one night, and I asked the Lord to take my sins away. And I felt my sins being lifted off of me, and I felt peace and joy in my heart. And after that, I came to the Christian Foundation, and I've been there ever since serving the Lord.
How long has that been?
That's been almost 8 months.
Well, praise the Lord. You know, there's something about that new birth when Jesus Christ really enters into the heart that you can't really explain to anyone. I know so many times the young Christians that are just newly born again, the frustration of trying to reach another person with what they feel in their heart and in their soul. It's just impossible to make anyone else to really understand that it is physical, mental, spiritual. It's everything in the world. It's everything combined, something so great and so powerful that it's beyond the capabilities of human words and human understanding to be able to convey that to another person. I've seen young Christians come in and kneel down and see the tears running down their face, and you would actually just see a light come into their eye and see their whole face just begin to shine. Yeah. And then see them trying to explain to someone else what really has happened to them. They know it, they feel it, but it's just impossible, really, to make another person to understand what God has really done for you. And Mark, we're so glad that you're there. We're glad that Jesus found you. I'm sure you didn't find him. He knew where you was all
Amen.
The time.
Praise the Lord.
Because he does look upon the heart. The Lord bless you. And now, Tony Alamo sings When Jesus Comes.
One sat alone beside the highway begging. His eyes were blind, a light he could not see. He clutched his rags and shivered in the shadows. Then Jesus came and made his darkness flee. When Jesus comes, the tempter's power is broken. When Jesus comes, all fears are wiped away. Takes the gloom and fills the light with glory. For all is changed when Jesus comes to stay. Some men today have found the Savior. They could not conquer passion, lust, and sin. Their broken hearts had left them sad and lonely. Then Jesus came and dwelled himself within. Jesus comes, the tempter's power broken. When Jesus
Have times really changed, and has the heart of the human that the Almighty God created, has it changed any since the beginning of time? Or is it the same as it was during the time of Jesus Christ, the time that he walked the shores of Galilee and brought the message of the kingdom of God with him? Has it changed since the days that he was an outcast from the churches? And these messages that he brought were in the hills of Judea. What kind of people's hearts were turned towards that man, Christ Jesus? People from every walk of life. The lame, the blind, the leper, the wealthy, the poor, the religious. Many of the religious people saw the hypocrisy of their lives and their ways, and they too turned and followed Jesus Christ, our Lord. God looks upon the heart of man, not the outward appearance, but he searches deep into the heart and the soul and bringeth forth that which is good created by him. And only God can actually know the heart of man, and that is good within him. I think so often about Jesus Christ and the people that followed him as he preached in the hills of Judea and as he preached in the sands by the sea, the outcast of the churches that wasn't even allowed to go into a synagogue because the people said that he was an illegitimate child and he wasn't allowed in the synagogues. But yet people from every type of life, every background, followed him and believed the message that he brought. And yet there were those with their hearts that were as hard as stone. And they looked at this man, Jesus Christ, many of them with jealousy, many with hatred, many with contempt, as the people followed him. And the churches and the sinful, the ungodly, the hard-hearted, they rose up and they said, let's put a stop to this emotional thing. Look what this man is doing to these people. Why, they're leaving their homes. They're leaving their churches. They're leaving their possessions behind. And they're following this fanatic into the hills. They're following him around by the seashore. How can this be that this thing is of God when suddenly people's lives take such a complete change and they're willing to lay down everything in the past and follow after him? This is a fanatical thing. It's an emotional thing. It's an outburst. And if there isn't a stop put to this thing, why, it'll crush the churches. It'll destroy the political structure. It'll destroy the social structure. Something must be done about Jesus Christ. It's terrible. Many of these people that are following after him, they're sincere. But he's deceiving them because he's a deceiver. He's a faker. He's a phony. He is actually telling these people that he is the Son of God, that he is the Messiah, that he's the promised one of Israel. The Jews are believing him. The Gentiles are believing him. The heathens are believing him. The cults are breaking up and they're following after him. Something must be done about this man, Jesus Christ. So they conspired between themselves to put him to death. Let's put the leader to death. Let's persecute him. Let us even crucify him. Let's nail him upon a cross. If this is what must be done to stop this emotional, fanatical outburst, then proceed and let's put this man to death and put a stop to this thing. So Jesus Christ, the Son of the living God, was arrested. And he was taken before the courts. And as he looked at some of these people, his accusers, and he said, what am I being condemned for? What are you convicting me for? Is it because of the blind eyes that I opened? Is it because of the lepers that I have healed? Is it because of the people of despair, the people whose souls that were lost, that I have brought them this eternal plan of salvation? Are these the charges that you have against me? Which of my good works are you crucifying me for? But yet they screamed all the louder, let him be crucified. And after they had beaten him beyond all recognition, he was dragged out to the hill of Golgotha. And there he was nailed to an old rugged cross. and hung between heaven and earth and shed his blood for our sins. Did that put an end to Calvary? Did that stop the gospel of Jesus Christ? My friend, it started the greatest revival, a revival that has lasted for 2,000 years. There isn't anything new about the Jesus movement. There isn't anything new about people raising their hands and praising God. There isn't anything new about people saying, "Look, once I was blind, but now I see." But there was another man, another group of people, even after Jesus Christ had been crucified, and still this great move was going on. And they conspired between themselves again. What can we do? Because it's bringing trouble back into the churches. It's bringing trouble back into the political structure. It's bringing trouble into the social structure. What can we do? And the Apostle Paul, a defiant Jew, said, "I'm going to teach these people once and for all. I'll teach them. I'll kill every Jew that raises up and says that he is a Hebrew Christian. I'll kill him. I'll have him be put to death. And this became his life's work, to persecute the people of God. And the Apostle Paul was on the road to Damascus after some Jews that had become Christians, when suddenly there was a blinding light, and there appeared unto him Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ! Jesus Christ, the same Christ that we crucified, that we put to death. I met him face to face on the road to Damascus. And he said, the light was so blinding that I was blinded by his light. And I fell upon my face and I cried out unto him, Lord, Lord. And Jesus said, Paul, Paul, you foolish one. You foolish one, why persecutest thou me? The Apostle Paul stood upon his feet, and he made his way into Damascus by the orders of the same Christ that he had sanctioned to be put to death, him and his people. And Jesus Christ made him the greatest follower of him that had ever been. He was the greatest of all the apostles. And that same Paul, that misguided Pharisee, that Hebrew, God broke that heart into a million pieces. And he took him and he turned him around and he made him the greatest soul winner of all time. All kinds of people follow Jesus Christ. How about your life? Are you a Pharisee? Are you a sinner? What are your problems? Whatever. Whoever, there is room at the cross for you. Jesus died, he shed his blood, that you can be set free. There is room at the cross for you.
He is the fountain as wide as the sea.
This program was recorded on December 15th, 1973.